60 Minutes Rewind.
For a long time, astronomers saw the asteroids and comets that come close to Earth as useless debris, space rocks that blocked our view of distant galaxies. Not anymore. They're now viewed as scientifically important and potentially very dangerous if they were to collide with our planet. The odds of that happening on any given day are remote, but over millions of years, scientists believe there have been lots of impacts, and few doubt there are more to come. A former astronaut told us it's like a game of cosmic roulette, and one mankind cannot afford to lose. Concern over our ability to detect these objects that come near the Earth grew after an incident in Russia this February, when an asteroid crashed into the atmosphere with many times the energy of the bomb dropped on Hiroshima, narrowly missing a city of 1 million. This is video of that asteroid in Russia, barreling toward Earth at 40,000 miles an hour. It exploded into pieces 19 miles above and 25 miles south of the city of Chelyabinsk. People thought it had missed them entirely until minutes later when the shockwave arrived. Shattering glass, crushing doors, and knocking some people right off their feet. More than 1,000 were injured.
How much warning did people in Chelyabinsk have?
None.
Paul Chodas is a scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. He and his boss, Don Yeomans, have been trying to track near-Earth objects for decades.
We didn't see it coming. It was coming from the general direction of the sun, so it was in the daytime sky as it approached.
So how did you find out about it?
Twitter and YouTube, when we first saw the images.
So the first people at NASA heard about it was Twitter?
Exactly.
Chodas says an object this size hits Earth once every 100 years on average. Yet the same day, purely by chance, another asteroid twice as large came within 17,000 miles of Earth, passing between us and the satellites that are bringing you this broadcast. The only reason there was any advance warning was because an amateur astronomer in Spain, an oral surgeon by day, noticed it just before it moved out of view.
We know about some of the most distant galaxies in the known universe, and yet we don't really know everything that's right in our own backyard.
Wow.
Amy Mainzer is a NASA scientist who focuses on detecting asteroids.
So we got to move the dome out of the way, and then we're going to start to follow the asteroid as it tracks across the sky.
This telescope at the Table Mountain Observatory in California is one of dozens all over the world that are used to track and study near-Earth objects. Mainzer told us they're often very hard to find.
Some of these asteroids are really, really dark, darker even than coal in some cases, kind of like the soot at the bottom of a barbecue grill.
So you're looking for something that's darker than coal against a black sky.
Exactly. And now you see the problem.
Another problem is that ground-based telescopes can't see objects coming from the direction of the sun because they're in the daytime sky, like the asteroid that hit Russia. Astronomers find asteroids by taking repeated pictures of the night sky and looking for things that change position. Professionals and amateurs all over the world work together sharing information. Once Paul Chodas and his NASA colleagues have multiple sightings, they can predict an object's location as far as 100 years into the future.
This particular object has a very well-known orbit.
The asteroid Amy Mainzer was observing the night we visited didn't look like much on her screen.
That little thing?
Yep, that's it.
But it's nearly half a mile wide and capable of destroying an entire continent.
So that's actually, that's a huge asteroid.
Yeah, it's a huge asteroid. If something this size hit the Earth, it would be devastating. It would be very bad.
Asteroids are composed mostly of rock, comets, ice, and dust. They come in all shapes and sizes. Some look like small planets, others giant dog bones. For a long time, nobody thought they were worth tracking at all.
It wasn't thought that they really did hit the Earth. Astronomers debated for a long time about the nature of the craters on the moon.
They thought the craters on the moon were volcanic.
Possibly, yeah. And it's only been fairly recently, within the last 50 years or so, that the field has really recognized that, yeah, impacts actually do happen. And not only do they happen on geological timescales, millions and billions of years, but on human timescales in some cases.
The last major asteroid to collide with Earth hit in 1908 in the Tunguska region of Siberia. It's believed to have been 40 yards wide and to have exploded in the air like a nuclear bomb, leveling 80 million trees in an area the size of metropolitan Washington. This crater in northern Arizona was created 50,000 years ago. It's one of more than 180 impact craters geologists have found so far. They think there are many more, hidden by water and vegetation, more even than on the moon, because the Earth's gravity is greater. The most famous impact of all is the one that may have wiped out the dinosaurs more than 65 million years ago. The theory is that an enormous asteroid or comet collided so violently with Earth, it created a cloud of debris that blocked out the sun, killing off 75% of all species, leaving behind a crater in Mexico more than 100 miles wide.
These are objects that were once in space, pieces of asteroids.
Yeomans and CHOTUS showed us some of the remarkable things that have fallen from the sky.
This is a piece of Mars.
You have it in your hand. Yeah. It wandered around the inner solar system for a few million years, and a 40-pound stone came down in Africa about 10 feet from a farmer in October of 1962.
That's the, it's amazing to think this is from Mars. It's from,
yeah, I know.
They played a trick on me as well.
Say, would you hand that one to me, that big one? Yeah. come on.
Oh my God.
This one was iron nickel and heavy as an anvil. Not all asteroids are made of such dense stuff, but many contain high concentrations of valuable minerals like platinum that might someday be mined in space.
We'll start by sending astronauts to an asteroid for the first time in history.
President Obama's proposed budget for next year includes a plan to capture a tiny asteroid so that astronauts could rendezvous with it by 2025. The idea is to perfect techniques needed to explore deep space, and perhaps find a way to exploit the water resources that many comets and asteroids have.
You could extract water from them. You can break the water down into hydrogen and oxygen, which is the most efficient form of rocket fuel. So asteroids may serve as the fueling stations and watering holes for future planetary exploration.
But as the scriptwriters of the Hollywood blockbuster Armageddon vividly imagine, asteroids have the potential to harm mankind as well. For better or worse, this is what many of us know about near-Earth objects. That if Bruce Willis hadn't nuked one, it would have destroyed the world.
You see these movies with Bruce Willis where an asteroid is coming and is going to destroy the world. Is that likely?
No. No. We found 95% of the large ones, and none of them represent a threat in the next 100 years or so.
What about the other 5%?
We're still looking.
He's talking about objects over half a mile wide that are big enough to cause global destruction. The problem is there are lots of smaller objects over 40 yards in diameter that are unaccounted for and potentially very dangerous.
The story will continue after this.
If you look at the light green dot, that's the orbit of the Earth.
Ed Liu is a former astronaut who spent 6 months on the International Space Station. He showed us a computer-generated representation of our solar system. That's the sun in the center, and those green dots are 10,000 near-Earth objects astronomers have found so far.
So these green dots are the asteroids that could hit the Earth.
This is about the 10,000 known asteroids.
Yes, these are the 10,000 known asteroids. Here's the problem. There's about a factor of 100 more. The real solar system looks like this. And we know this because we've only been able to observe a small fraction of the sky, and we know that there's about 100 times more asteroids
than we've found. Wait, this is all the asteroids that are...
There are about a million asteroids large enough to destroy a city out there.
And right now we only know of what percent of those asteroids?
About 0.5%.
Does it worry you that you only know 1% of these asteroids that are big enough to destroy a city?
Well, most of those are really small, and the odds are that many of these would hit in a remote area or it could hit in an ocean. So that is why the larger ones are those that we were paying attention to first. Now, the next size range is the one to concentrate on, those that can cause, you know, continent-wide extinction or destruction.
Yeah, that would be pretty good to prevent that continent-wide destruction.
Those are the next ones. We'll continue to find those, and we work our way down to the small ones.
But right now, an object that could wipe out the Eastern Seaboard or New York City could be a day away, and there's a very good chance we wouldn't know about it.
Well, we're working to make sure that we will know about it.
But right now, we wouldn't know about it.
It's possible, yes.
The Committee on Science, Space, and Technology will come to order.
NASA Administrator Charles Bolden faced similar questions from Congress after the near miss in Russia earlier this year.
What would we do? if you detected even a small one, like the one that detonated in Russia, headed for New York City in 3 weeks, what would we do?
If it's coming in 3 weeks, pray.
Is there anything you can do to deflect an asteroid that's going to hit besides evacuating a city?
If you find it 10 or 20 or 30 years in advance, then yes, you could actually send a spacecraft up, run into it, slow it down a millimeter or two per second so that in 10 or 20 years when it was predicted to hit the Earth, it wouldn't.
Just slam a spacecraft into it.
Just slam into it.
In 2005, NASA did just that as an experiment, firing a small unmanned spacecraft into a comet called Tempel 1. But you can't deflect what you don't detect, which is why former astronaut Ed Liu has taken on a new mission.
Here's the telescope that we're building.
He's now chairman of the B612 Foundation, which has designed a space-based telescope to speed up the discovery of near-Earth objects. NASA's Amy Mainzer has been developing one, too. Both telescopes would be able to find asteroids by using infrared sensors that detect heat rather than light. But a telescope like this would cost roughly $500 million, and so far, neither the United States nor any other government has committed significant funds. So the B612 Foundation is trying to raise the money privately by reaching out to individual donors.
I don't think there's any other global catastrophe, global-scale catastrophe, that we can prevent. This is the only one that I know of. We can solve this particular issue for the cost of building a freeway overpass. I mean, that's literally what it is.
But nobody has been killed by an asteroid.
Yeah. And what I'm saying is that you can't wait till that point afterwards when you say we should have done it. You have to think of this as cosmic roulette, right? The phrase that they have in Vegas is that the house always wins. And, you know, the sort of secret to all this is that we're not the house. At some point, you know, the solar system's going to get you.
They're very low probability events, but very high consequence events.
The problem, it seems like, is you're asking people to care about something which may not affect their lives, may not even affect their children's lives.
That's true. Mm-hmm. It's a tough concept to get across because, as you say, it's something that may not happen for another 100 years, 200 years. It may happen tomorrow morning.